well as a new build, laneways, and of course, Valentine's department store building to the right of us survived the earthquakes. That building was with us before and still with us now. It's the one where the rock and cafes, and to the building to the left is a new build, got finished off in August last year. Nike and Helly Hansen moved in there 17 weeks ago. Staying left, two souvenir shops are in a building that also survived the earthquakes. The third of the three buildings that survived the earthquakes is Valentine's, coming up to the right front of the tram. Everything else, pretty much left and right of us, has all gone up sometime after 2012. So lots of buildings along this stretch or this block that have all gone up in the last 5 to 10 years. Laneways to the right of us with Guthrie Centre there, links through to retail, hospitality. Laneways to the left there with 5 lanes, 2 entrances, and again gets you back to retail and hospitality in behind. Via the laneways you can also get back to the terrace where we were a short while ago. Front right of us is Ballantyne's. Wasn't always Ballantyne's though, it started out as Dunstable House back in the 1850s and 1872. John Ballantyne bought it, renamed it Ballantyne's. It's been in the Ballantyne's family trading as a department store ever since. Some 150 years plus now. A very short list anywhere of department stores that have been operating for 150 years, but that certainly is the story with Ballantyne's just to the right of us there. This is stop number 5, your stop for Ballantyne's, any of the other retail that might have caught your eye, as well as the bus exchange just located front right of the tram. We're going to head into the second block where all the buildings, it's a similar story, they've all gone up sometime after 2012. Typically, again, buildings coming up in the next block of all around 5 to 10 years old. The difference with this next block is the two facades, one on the corner there. That was a keeper. Just the facade though, with copper brand, and the facade above Country Road. That one dates back to 1901. Yeah, everything in behind to the right of us is all new stuff. All new buildings attached to those two old facades there. Typically, it's a whole block's worth in behind to the right, from Cashel Street all the way through to Litchfield Street, a whole hectare's worth. Quite a major development here to the right. Lots of retail, lots of hospitality down there. You've got Fresh Choice Supermarket down the far end there, as well as a good hospitality offering midway down level 1. Stop number 6. From here we're going to head through and cover off stop 6. Sorry, cover off stop 7 and 8. Station, the Gondola, in 10 minutes. Top station. Good views today over the back into Littleton Harbour, also known as Whakaraupo, Banks Peninsula over there. Created some 10 million years ago when two volcanoes over there blew up, creating what is now known as Littleton Harbour, as well as Akaroa Harbour. Gives you good views back over this way, over the city, out toward that way, out toward the west, the Southern Alps, as well as the east. Pegasus Bay, the big bike, and beyond. If you're new to town, just passing through, let's give you a good view of Christchurch and where it sits in relation to Mid-Canterbury here. This isn't a hop-on, hop-off stop. This is just for us to obey the traffic signals. This one, we do need to stop and wait for a green. Front left of us, there's some cranes in the skyline. That's Te Kaha, the Christchurch Inner City Stadium, currently under construction, well out of the ground now. Starting to frame up all the stadium and all the seating, expected to have 30,000 seats in it. Looking at a completion date of middle of 2026. And at the moment it's on budget, sitting on a budget of around $683 million. So at capacity, 30,000 people, so it is expected that this part of town will grow going forward. And temporary population, I guess, to this part of town. This part of town is known as the Salt District. It's short for St. Asaph Street, Litchfield Street, and John Street, and they're the streets that run through this particular part of the city, the Salt District. To the left of us, very much apartment buildings, residential. And to the right of us, pretty much hospitality, a good offering of eateries, bars, and restaurants. And then straight in front, of course, we've got the stadium under construction. So to the left of the tram, get a good look at what that looks like a little closer. As we head right into hospitality hub. And then, of course, we've got Duck Central coming up to the left of us. That is an English-style garden bar. Not sure about this thing. We're going to move through to stop 7 here. Stop 7 is your stop if you're looking to track down a little high eatery located back here. First one, stop 7. Itself is brand new and behind, and again they keep the old facade on the front of the old Connors building. Connors Lane 158. So gorgeous sweet facade there at the front and a brand new building in behind. So in some ways best of both worlds. You get the old facade and you get a brand new building in behind. Best of all worlds is Smash Palace. To the right there, that's an open air bar. Should get busy this afternoon. Stay busy through the evening. It was built for a day like today. It's a summer bar. It's a bus in the bar, and the bar's in the bus. Like I said, built for a summer's day such as this one. We're on the east side of Manchester Street. Manchester Street's just in front of us, and this side of Manchester Street down this way is known as East Frame or One Central. Typically apartment buildings that have been built across several blocks there. They're yet to build out about 3 or 4 blocks, but generally speaking, 2/3 of it's now sort of complete or built out. That part of town was earmarked for 800 additional apartments. So the inner city permanent population sits at around 7,000 people. This is stop number 8. Well, I imagine this part of the town, though, would get busier. Between that and a temporary population coming and going from the stadium, it would all serve to make this part of town a lot busier. That was a hole in the ground to the right of us. It was a big hole in the ground for about a decade. Diggers moved in there about 3 weeks ago. Was Holiday Inn prior to the earthquakes, 14-story building on that site to the right of us after the earthquake, simply unsafe, not financially viable to fix, so it had to come down. So as a result, there was a hole in the ground, exposed the basement and the underground car park. For about a decade, they had filled it in 3 weeks and looking to build something on it now. Sounds like it'll be retail on the ground floor and then office space on the levels above. This is the High Street Armour City Mall, very similar to the Cashel Armour City Mall where we were just moments ago, and then all the buildings left and right of us have all gone up sometime after the earthquake. So buildings around us all post 2012. And the ANZ Centre to the left of us there, it's typical of a new post-earthquake modern commercial building in the city. Lots of steel, lots of glass, all the glass is safety glass, all the steel's pretty much bolted together. Screw piles underneath that building go down around 30-33 metres. We built the city on a swamp, so generally speaking the ground beneath is not that firm. As a result, most commercial buildings do need screw piles underneath them, go down around 30-33 metres. Little storyboard there to the left, the city on a swamp, just to the left of the tram there. We're going to pull through to stop number 9. This is your stop if you're looking to get through to the transitional or cardboard cathedral. Located to the right of us, just down Hereford Street here, 2 blocks. Spark building, front right, similar as far as the ANZ Centre. Lots of steel, lots of glass, screw piles underneath the building. Buildings, both cases, go up 28 metres, which is typically the average for the buildings in the city now. Above ground, about 28 metres. Below ground, anywhere from 30 to 33 metres. That's the screw pile, it's not the building. to shoot around the cathedral now, cover off the south, the east, the north and the west before we get back through to stop at bar two. Started building the Christchurch Cathedral back in 1864. It took 40 years to build it. More recent times, they are now 3 years into a 7-year restoration and reinstatement project. To the left of the tram, get a view on the south side. We're on the south side now of the cathedral. Look like you'll notice there's a spire missing. It's in the picture, it's not on the building. Now that's got to go back up in the earthquake, one of the major earthquakes, which was on the 22nd of February 2011. It did damage the spire significantly, but didn't bring it down. It was one of the following aftershocks that brought the spire down. They've still got to rebuild the spire on the northwestern corner. We'll get a peek at that in a moment here. I'm going to shoot around the back here. All the big steel I-beams around the back of the building are all part and parcel of all the stabilisation work that's gone on. To the left, if we look left up high, you can see the top of the cathedral, the top of the main building to the left, the top of the roof. And the spire itself towers above that twice as high. So stay looking left, and we've got a yellow fence or yellow gate coming up to the left of us. If you look through the yellow gate, you go, David, there's nothing there. That's where the spire should be. That's where it was. You do see a gaping grey hole in the corner of the building, cover the first bit. That's where the spire should be. Stay looking left. On the purple fence here, it gives you a look at what the spire did look like on this northwestern corner and what it will look like once they rebuild it. If you're looking for a bit more information around the cathedral or wander along the purple fence, it's quite informative and good pictures. Pretty much give you a look at what this cathedral here will look like once it's finished. This is the western side, so the main entrance will be on this side. This is stop number two for the second time. Stop two for the second time.
Thank you. Thank you.
During and after the earthquakes, buildings were damaged either during the earthquakes when they came down or after the earthquakes of 2010 and 2011. Damaged so much so that they had to get taken down afterwards. And as such, we had lost around 1,200 buildings. And in that mix, we lost about 80% of our heritage buildings. So there's the odd heritage buildings splattered around the city. But generally speaking, the best of what we've got left is coming up down here, down Worcester Boulevard. First of such buildings will be the Queen Anne style red brick building coming up here. Just the right front of the tram now. That dates back to the mid-1880s, done by an architect called Samuel Hirst Seeger. Gorgeous old building. It's been in the restoration program, that building there, since 2021. Expecting that to be finished toward the end of this year. Early next year, realistically, probably another year away. A lot of detail in it. It's one of the very few we have left done in that particular style of architecture, so it's definitely a keeper. But a lot of detail in it. It's taking a long time to get it through the restoration. This is stop number 10, Worcester Boulevard. And this is Worcester Bridge before we hit the boulevard. River Avon running underneath us from left to right. It starts at a suburb called Avonhead. Makes its way into the city, leaves us to the right, makes its way out to a suburb called South Bright, ends up in an estuary there before it finally ends up in the South Pacific Ocean, some 26 kilometres from source. We're now on Worcester Boulevard. Good stuff down here. You've got the Art Gallery, the Art Centre and the Botanic Gardens. All three of those things are free, free to enter, free to wander around, free to spend as much time as you like. The Art Gallery, Tapuna Row Waifetu, building just to the right of us coming into view now, that is very much open for another hour 45, closes today at 5 p.m. So we've still got time to dart in there and have a look. The building itself is about 20 years old now, opened back in 2003. It had a cost back then of $45 million, which seems like a bargain now given the cost of building for the city, for commercial buildings, but back then it was a lot of money, and it still really is today. This is stop number 11. This is gorgeous part of town coming up here left. There's a whole block's worth of buildings. 23 buildings in total. The vast majority of them are done in Gothic Revival style of architecture. 21 of the 23 buildings are here in Category 1, Heritage Listed Buildings. Of course, the buildings did suffer a lot of damage through the earthquakes. It's taken well over a decade to get the buildings back to where they are now, but it's simply stunning what they've managed to do, considering the buildings are anywhere from 108 to 145 years old. There certainly was no earthquake strengthening back when these buildings were originally built, so now they're kind of better in that sense. They've got earthquake strengthening, and the buildings probably, in all honesty, look as good as they ever did. So the restoration work is simply second to none. The workmanship is second to none. This is top 12 for the Art Centre. Good collection of buildings down here. Whoa, what's that? A couple of buildings in the middle yet to get through the restoration program. They are just to the left of us coming into view now. These buildings, sounds like they're about $30-35 million shy of getting those buildings through. So they'll have to wait until the coffers are topped up, and then they'll get back to those buildings. But all the stabilisation work is done on them. The buildings are expected to get completed or finished in the coming years. It does give you a good before and after, though, what the buildings look like before restoration work, and then beyond the fence here to the left, Bunsen Cafe and the clock tower, what the buildings again look like after restoration. Clock tower to the left there is the 145-year-old building, completed back in 1879. So it's the first building to be built on this site, and the first building to be through the restoration work. So it is a stunning part of this collection of buildings. This is stop number 13. Canterbury Museum straight in front of us. Unfortunately, that's closed. It will remain closed for another 3 years. It's 1 year into a 4 year redevelopment, and there's a lot going on in there. It's expected to cost over $200 million. The building itself, what we can see at the front, they'll retain that, and the side, the south side, they'll retain that, but generally speaking, in behind the building there's a lot of walls being removed. They're looking to future proof the building, I suppose, do some earthquake strengthening. Quite a bit done back in the 1970s, a bit more of that to do, but more importantly, they're better, looking to better accommodate the exhibits and that they have in there, and it was time to actually reconfigure the whole building. So there's actually quite a bit going on in behind. If you look down the laneway to the left of us, you get a look at what's missing, which is basically most of the building in behind. It's quite a major piece of redevelopment, as they say, so it's still a good 3 years away. To the left of us coming into view now is Price College, a secondary school for boys, just shy of 700 boys on the roll there. Currently 200 of those boys are boarders. And that building to the left of us is their dining hall. That's where they do breakfast, lunch and dinner. Oh, it's simply spectacular. Dates back to the early 1920s. If you stay looking left, you get a look through the main gates here at some of the other magnificent buildings on this side. The campus is simply littered with gorgeous old buildings. Christ College itself was established back in 1857, so it's been here 167 years. They originally founded Christ College in Littleton when the original ships, or the first four ships, turned up in the early 1850s. They established Christ College over there in Littleton. 7 years later, they moved across to this side. Christ College has been here ever since. Referred to as Festival Field, or called Entertainment Triangle. It's a little corner of North Hackley here. It has the Polyfest on today, so it's actually quite busy for Saturday. When this guy comes through, this Polyfest just to the left of us. Festival Field, as I refer to it. It's where all the concerts, things like concerts and events are held through the summer months. In the winter months, it reverts back to playing fields, rugby fields and soccer fields. Stop number 14 on North Hadley. I'm going to ask him. That's the easiest way. Oh, they're from Timaru. You guys had a good day?
Yes!
I don't know, was it just the festival or was it a competition?
It's a festival.
Oh, right. That's what the guys in Lewes usually say. Have a good day, guys.
Timaru, for those of you from overseas, Timaru is a couple of hours south. Right. Yeah, I was waiting for that. It's a competition when you win, it's a festival when you lose. That's genuine. Right! Oh, just a sec. We better let this bus get around the corner. So, all of our central city streets are named after places. They're named after Anglican cathedral cities or bishoprics around what was the British Empire back in the 19th century. Montreal, Durham, Barbados, Antigua, Madras, Colombo, Manchester, Hereford, Cashel, all cathedral cities back in Empire days. The Anglican threads run very, very deep in this city. This park here, Cranmer Square, one of over 1,200 in the city, is named after one of the Oxford Martyrs, one of the three bishops who started the Church of England back in the 16th century, Bishop Thomas Cranmer. I won't go into detail what happened to him. This is stop 15. Let's just say he ran into Mary Tudor, and it did not end at all well, so they've named a park after him. There was also Bishop Latimer. He also ran into Mary Tudor and also did not end well. Thanks, guys. Tramps every 20 or so. And he's got a park named after him on the other side of the town. There was also Bishop Ridley. He ran into Mary Tudor, didn't end well, but he didn't get a park named after him. They were going to name Cathedral Square after him, but they decided to name it after the cathedral and square, so he missed out, and he'll have to sink into oblivion unrecognised. Right, what have we got? Oh yeah, so New Zealand's a rugby mad nation. Canterbury's madder than most. And there's a plaque in the corner of this park that claims the very first game of rugby union ever played in New Zealand was played right here beside us in 1863. Now that's quite controversial, because if you happen to go up to Nelson at the top of the South Island, they've got a plaque on their cathedral that says pretty much the same thing. So two different cities claim the first game. I genuinely don't know which one is correct. They wouldn't have recognised the game they played though. 23 aside, lasted 3 hours, ended in a nil-all draw. Almost as boring as football there. Right, next stop. Superb little museum called Quake City. You've still got time to visit. It's open till 5. A whole museum all about the earthquakes. So if you'd like to learn more about what happened here and how we dealt with it, personal stories, memorabilia and video footage, Quake City is the spot to do it, and it's right beside us at the next stop, stop 60. $20 for adults, children for free, not to be honest, just here on the corner. If you don't feel like a museum, the other thing you can do from this stop is visit the casino. That's a couple hundred metres to our left. We've had a legal casino here since the 1990s, just down the road. Stop 16. I don't think any of you will be surprised to learn most of our churches were damaged or destroyed in the earthquakes. The casino, just fine, no problems whatsoever. They should get casino architects to build churches and cathedrals, might save everyone some grief. Casinos are just temples to mammon anyway, it's not much of a stretch. Right, we're about to head down to Victoria Square now. This was marketplace when the city first began, where there used to be heavy trade between Naipahu and the early European settlers. That carried on through the 19th century. Just as we approach there though, in front of us the convention centre on the right, I still think this corner of it looks like a stormtrooper's helmet out of Star Wars. Once you see that, you're stuck with it. So, marketplace on the left, you can see the cobblestone ramp down to the river just down there where they used to water the horses back in the 19th century. So, 1901, Her Majesty Queen Victoria died, so they named it after her. Australia loved Queen Victoria so much they named two whole states after it. We figured this bit of lawn was enough for us, so Victoria Square. We're pulling up into stop 17, statue of Queen Victoria right beside us. The earthquakes didn't bother her in the slightest. Most of our male statues fell down and broke. Arms, legs and heads went flying. She just stood there scowling through the whole thing, never moved a millimeter. If you're looking to relax, this is the best place in the city centre. There's the river, a bit of bush, lovely sculptures, flowers, trees, seats under the trees, no shops, no one's trying to take your money. Just sit, breathe deep, put my max with it. You'll often hear of Christchurch referred to as Oklopahi. That used to be, oh, couldn't sneak through. I'll tell you, that used to be a pile, a fortified village, a few hundred metres around the river, and in front of us, we have Badal Street, across this river. I don't think we've got any children on board anymore, but there's a children's playground coming up, Takaroa Mapoi, the Margaret Mayhew Playground, top city block just for kids. Swing slides, flying foxes, water features, and sand pits, always open, always free. Very much loved by the local children, not to be missed, just in front of us. And then if you look off to the left, in front of that band rotunda over there, if you look carefully, you might see a couple of prows sticking out of the water there. There's a couple of waka tewai, or river canoes, over the river there, traditional canoes. They use paddling up and down the river, so come have a look at those, just walk over. Right, your Regent Street. So you've got Casa Publica, Boutique Rum Bar just on the corner there. Rollicking Gelato for ice cream. There's a gin bar, a whiskey bar, a rum bar, a wine bar, and a dive bar all down here. The last word, whiskey bar, my favourite bar. 700 plus different single malts in there. I know. It's not 18, your Regent. Right, I've sold them on the whiskey. Where they are. And then my favourite bar slogan is just in front of us on the left, Wilco. They're a five-star dive bar. I just think that's perfect. There you go. Right, by the way, the guy, if you look into Wilco, you see a guy with a hat with lots of badges on in there. He wins prizes. He does the best cocktails in the city. He's absolutely brilliant. Lovely little Thai restaurant here, fried chicken, waffles, all sorts. Looks like they're setting up some, oh, someone's having a wedding function just here on the left. There you go. Best day of their lives. Waffle House, they'll be open till 10 tonight. And then later on, if you want to have a little gin incident, just on the left here, it's the gin bar of the year, the last few years, they got church pews out the front. Completely respectful. Don't need to tell you what they sell. Right, we're coming through to stop by the Cathedral Junction, the home of the trams. It's where our ticket office is. It's the only place we go inside. So I'm here, I'm hopping off here. David's going to take you out for another few laps. Just a reminder, the last tram will leave this stop here at 10 to 6 for the last lap of the day. It'll actually be this tram. So this tram's basically got 3 laps left. Us for the day.
All 18 stops again. From here back to here. 18 stops, 50 minutes. Get you around the tracks. Just in case you're not aware of it, your tram ticket is still good, of course, on any of the trams out there. So you're more than welcome to hop off a tram, visit whatever you wish to visit, and then hop back on any of the other trams. And all trams will stop automatically at all of the stops along the way, so very much. Well, hop off and hop back on any of the others. All trams and all tram drivers will stop automatically at all the stops for you to hop off and back on again. And move on through to stop number 2 from here. Then we'll cover off stops 3 through 9, which is all the retail, hospitality part of town. The shops, basically. Thanks a lot. To the right of us, you've got Turunga, the Christchurch Central City Library. That's very much open. 3 or 5, so running out of time there. We'll close at 5 today. But well worth a visit. Level 1 there with the orange wall is kid friendly. All sorts of goodies on offer up there if you've got children. Well worth a visit. I'm going to stop here and jump out for a moment. There's a cone in the way, and if we run over, we tend to get them tangled up in the tram, which is never good. Thanks a lot. As I said, stop number 2 coming up, Cathedral Square. We go through here twice to complete a full circuit of the city. It's pretty much a lopsided figure 8. First lap, first loop I should say, is around to the left, the south side of the city, and then we come back through here, stop number 2 for a second time, and complete a loop to the north, the right side. So in order to complete a full circuit of the city, you come through here, stop number 2 twice. This is the first of 2 times. Right off the shops. We head around onto what used to be Oxford, well, it kind of still is Oxford Terrace, but it's been fully pedestrianised for many decades. It's Oxford Terrace. to a street that in more recent times post-earthquake has been pedestrianised. Now it's a very nice part of the city. The Avon Promenade, which follows the Avon River for about 2 kilometres. Rather picturesque part of the city. Starts out a kilometre in front of us, follows the river a kilometre all the way around to Christchurch Public Hospital, and then finishes a kilometre behind us near the Margaret May Children's Playground. River Avon to the right of us there, so it follows the River Avon for its entirety. Very pretty part of the city. Very informative too, lots of little storyboards along the way, lots of information about different parts. The city down by the river there. This is stop number 3.